Good morning. I'd like to welcome everybody to the North Carolina Radon webinar series. This is our second in our series for February, but our sixth in the total series. My name is Sarah Kirby. I'm an Assistant Director of Cooperative Extension at NC State Extension and a housing specialist, and I have the pleasure of serving as your technical host today. Just so you know, before we get started, we will monitor the chat box, which is where you can ask questions. And at the end of our time together, we hope to answer all of those. And if for some reason those don't all get answered, we'll make sure that they are answered in due time. Philip Gibson, who is our real host, will be keeping a list of everybody who has participated in these webinars, and so we can follow up with you with emails and additional information if necessary. The other thing I ask you to do is please keep yourself on mute so that we don't disrupt the speaker and we don't disrupt the time that the rest of our participants have. But with that, I will turn it over to Philip Gibson, who is a North Carolina Radon Specialist with the North Carolina Radon Program. And he's the one who thought of this webinar series, and I'm so glad that he did, because it's certainly been an eventful and a rewarding experience for our participants as well as myself. So Philip, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Kirby, and thank you once again. I know I say this at each webinar, but thank you once again for sharing your time, your expertise, and making the webinar technology of North Carolina State University available for this Radon webinar and the other webinars. To everyone, thank you for your participation. This session is being recorded, as are the others, and will later be made available at our website at ncradon.org. I want to also point out the support that we've had in reaching various target audiences for this and the other webinars. They're represented in the slide that has a number of logos on it. And I don't know, Sarah, if you have that slide up. Well, they are also in the announcement that you received when registering for the webinar. So our speaker today is Bill Brodhead, and Bill has been installing radon and vapor intrusion systems in residential and commercial and school buildings since 1984. We are really fortunate to have Bill Brodhead present today for a number of reasons. He has been a radon mitigation instructor at Rutgers University for 25 years. He has authored 17 research papers at AARST conferences. AARST is the professional organization for radon specialists, professionals. His papers include radon mitigation of commercial buildings, including those with radon coming from the concrete, which is the topic for today's webinar. So if you will, please join me in welcoming Mr. Bill Brodhead.
Okay, are we ready to start?
Yes, we are.
Okay, are my slides projected? I can't.
They are not yet projected.
Okay. You're working on that, or is that something I'm working on?
That's you. You need to.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I have to share my screen.
Correct.
All right, here we go. How's that?
It's
hello.
Perfect.
That's perfect. You got it going. Okay. All right. Well, let's get started. Hopefully, we have a nice crowd out there, and we'll go through some of the issues here that I discovered in doing some research work on two different buildings, and that's kind of what I want to talk about today, or the buildings that I have done work on. I have not been involved in, unfortunately, or fortunately, one way or the other, with doing a lot of mitigation on these buildings. So I can answer. So what I want to do is just present what I've discovered about these buildings, and now we just have to see if we can get them to slides. Oop, there we go. Okay, so these are the two buildings that we're going to talk about in the class in the session today. There was a building in North Carolina in Charlotte and one in Miami. And the one in Charlotte started 13 years ago. Someone at AARST came up to me and said, hey, we got radon on the fifth floor of a condo building. And fortunately, I was called in to go down and investigate it and able to make a whole bunch of measurements. And that's what we're going to review today. And then more recently, we got called all the way down to Miami, Florida. And when you know what, there's radon in these condo buildings in Miami. And so it's really a combination of there is some radon in almost all concrete, and the type of buildings you're building now are just getting tighter and tighter. And you combine these concrete buildings with hurricane-proof windows and doors, and suddenly the ventilation rates are getting really low. And in residential standards, there's not a strict requirement to add ventilation to these residential buildings the way commercial buildings are. So what's the difference between these two buildings? Well, they both have concrete slabs. That means you're getting emanation from the floor and the ceiling. And they, in the North Carolina building, had stairwells that also were concrete. And then in the Miami building, the actual interior walls dividing the bedrooms from the kitchen were solid concrete. So we had a lot of emanation there. The one building on the left had a parking garage below, and they went and investigated initially and found there wasn't radon in the parking garage. The building over in Miami is a slab on grade. And as you can see, the test results were we're getting an average of 8 picocuries in the North Carolina one, 10 picocuries. So looking at the results, you can see that of all the tests were above 4, there's 23 units were tested and went up as high as 16 picocuries. So pretty shocking. And the other thing that's shocking about it is this is not measurements in someone's basement. These are measurements in your bedroom 24 hours a day. So people, and this isn't one house, this is hundreds of people living in these condo buildings. So actually the exposure and risk is quite high in these buildings with the conditions that are happening here. The Miami building, and let's see if we can use a pointer here, was actually composed of 4 buildings. These 3 buildings all had open stairwells to the outside. In other words, you had an outdoor air entrance coming up and open always. The other building here actually had a conditioned hallway where they were blowing conditioned air down into the hallway. So it was getting a pressurized, because there was no returns, only supplies, a pressurized hallway. And you'll see when we look at the measurements how that affected the radon results in these buildings. So this is a chart of the radon concentrations, because they measured every single unit in this building, and there were 500 apartments in this condo association. So in the first set, we'll see that the average of the entire building is around 10. And then the question is, well, is there more on the first floor because there's slab on grade? And are we getting radon? Well, it turns out maybe in Florida, the sand, there's not really a lot of radon in the sand. It's down there, the sandy type soil. So the first floor is a little bit higher here. The first floor is about the same as the average here. The first floor is about the same. And over here, we're getting a little bit more on the first floor. So I'm not seeing that. We're also seeing really an incredible uniformity of radon results through 3 of the buildings. So all averaging between 6.5 and about 11 picocuries or 12 picocuries through the buildings. When we get over to the purple set on the right, that's building 4, and that's where it had a positive pressurized hallway pumping air down with about 30% outdoor air. I take it back, I said there was no returns. There actually was some returns in there, so it wasn't totally pressurized. But they were getting 30% outdoor air mixed in. So that building was running less, and even though it wasn't fully pressurized, and when we get to the end, I'll talk a little bit about how it changed. So in order to determine there's radon coming from concrete, there's a couple of ways to do it. One is to use what we call an accumulator, and it's just basically we take a metal bowl, put a radon monitor underneath it, seal it well to the floor, and then watch the ingrowth. Or you can use what we use different radon detectors for that. You can't use charcoal because it soaks up the radon, but you can use EPIRMS and continuous monitors. So that's one way to do a quick check if you wanted to know, hey, is there some radon coming out of this concrete? Or even in a building where you have a basement, you might want to check whether there's radon coming out of the concrete in the basement floor. And you would do what's called a flux test, and we'll look at how it's done. So the important measurement that I was making, however, was the variation in ventilation by pre-measuring the radon for 2 days, introducing outdoor air into the building and measuring that very carefully so I knew exactly how much outdoor air was coming in, then measuring the radon levels with this amount of outdoor air coming in, and that change would tell me how much radon is coming out of the concrete, what the initial ventilation is, and how much, more importantly too, how much air would be needed to get the radon levels low. Making flux measurements, Radelec came up with this unit called the H chamber, but where they extended it and modified it, but it's not really commonly available. So it's really not something that could probably practically be used. We just went out and bought some metal bowls, stuck EPIRMS underneath them, and sealed them to the floor, and it has to be bare concrete, so we would seal it underneath carpet, or we would seal it in a utility room, or in the stairwell, someplace where we could get down to the bare concrete and expose it in that space. And there are some issues with EPIRMS if you go and use it. And the nice thing about EPIRMS is you can make dozens of measurements. The bowls are cheap, the EPIRMS, you may have a whole set. And so you can make multiple measurements. But EPIRMS have some issues. One is you have to expose it for a short amount of time, usually only less than a day, and you're hoping to see a good voltage drop so that you get a reasonable signal. But you need to know how much radon is in the bowl prior to the test starting, so you have to measure the radon levels there. Also, sometimes it's only a small difference, so gamma can have a big effect, and so you need to know what the gamma level is. Once you're done, the formula is a little complicated, but I do have a paper that was presented at the AARST conference on radon and concrete that talks about the calculation you need to do. One way found to get the background reading is to take an EPIRM and put it in one of the radon and water jars, seal it in, close it up, and that way you're entrapping the radon that's the initial level, and you're also measuring the gamma at the time. So that's actually a practical way to subtract out the background when you're making that measurement. A simpler test is to put a radon monitor under a bowl. Well, a lot of the radon monitors are too big, so you need to find one that's small. We found one that works quite well called the Radon Eye because it happens to have a very high sensitivity rate. That means it's seeing a lot of counts per picocurie, and therefore the measurement tends to be a straighter line, kind of a flatter line, because it's got more counts to determine what the concentration is. And you're looking for the increase in radon. They work on a power, but you can substitute with a battery, and you just have to convert the battery from 5 volts to 12 volts, and you can use that for the measurement. We would use a gasket system and put some kind of weight on it on top to compress the gasket. One of the issues, however, with radon and any measurement of concrete or emanation or flux is there could be thoron. It's a lot more prevalent than anyone realizes, but because it's got a 55-second half-life, we normally we don't consider it to be an issue at all. Possibility for thoron, I have taken radon eyes and taped them with foil tape to cause the radon levels to emanate just through the plastic rather than through the openings. And that eliminates or minimizes the thoron contribution. But so there are some complications there. There's also a delay in the response of the CRM. So you have to kind of compensate for those kind of things. So what you do is you get that radon measurement that you got underneath the bowl, and you'll see that there's an ingrowth. It goes from 15 picocuries to 30 picocuries. And then over a period of time, in this case, 7 hours. So we got 15 picocuries in 7 hours. That tells us how much is coming into the bowl, 2.14 picocuries per hour. And now we have the volume of the bowl, and we have the area that it's touching, and then we have the delay factor, and we come up with a In this case, 21 picocuries per square foot per hour. And then, okay, what do we do with those numbers? Well, the one thing we were wondering is, well, is it consistent? Are we getting some variation from one location to another through the building? So in the first building we did in Charlotte, we did a lot of these measurements, and we found that there wasn't that much variation. I mean, we do have a 25 to 53, that's twice, but it's not a 10 to 1 variation. It's a 1 to 2 variation. So so that's a reasonable variation, and when you average those out, you can see that they average fairly similarly. So we kind of came to the conclusion that when it's coming out of the concrete, it seems to be fairly uniform. Of course, it could be from a different company that's getting a different mix of materials. And it's also interesting, when we had the one building, we were checking to see, is the radon coming from the cement? Is it coming from the stone? Is it coming from the sand? Is it coming from the fly ash, you know, whatever's mixed in there? And we actually made measurements of those in Charlotte from the concrete company. And believe it or not, we found a little bit of radon coming from all the materials, including the sand, which surprised me. And the most was from the concrete itself. Okay. I might also point out that in this, at the time I was doing this, I went to Home Depot and mixed up a bag of concrete to do another test. And I decided, wow, what's that bag of concrete I got from Home Depot? We should check and see how much radon's coming out of that concrete. And we were getting about, I was getting about 7 to 8 picocuries per square foot per hour coming out of a bag of concrete I found at Home Depot. So yes, indeed, concrete does emanate. And the question is it enough emanation to cause elevated radon levels? And it turns out that that's totally due to the ventilation rate of the building. So if we have a building and you saw some of the readings there, we had 50 picocuries per square foot per hour, and we take a building that's 8 feet tall. So that means we got 50 coming from the floor, and we have 50 coming from the ceiling. So that's 100 picocuries per hour entering. 8 cubic feet of air in that space is 226 liters. And then we do the math on that. And when we calculate the amount of radon that's contributing from that, it depends on the flushing of the ventilation. So ASHRAE typically recommends ACH, which is air changes per hour, of about 0.35 was the old number. There's actually some new calculations that I'll show, but it's still very similar. So at 0.35 air changes, we're looking at the contribution of that concrete of 1.3. So there's still some radon coming out of that concrete that could contribute radon even at a recommended air change rate that might be measurable. However, when you get the air change rate down to a third of that, 0.1, or seventh of that, 0.05, suddenly radon levels go to 8. And we were finding air change rates are even below 0.05 air changes per hour. So the issue predominantly was the buildings were extremely airtight. So in order to check how much air is needed to increase the ventilation to 0.35 and how much emanation we're actually getting, we did a ventilation test. And we used radon as what we call a tracer gas. The tracer was radon. It's emanating constantly out of the air. And we pre-measured it for 2 days, 1 to 2 days, and we got a radon concentration at the normal ventilation in the building. Then we add 30, 40, 50 CFM. We measure that very carefully. And then we measure the radon change over the next two. And that will define the ventilation rate of the building, how much actual natural ventilation, and the average concrete emanation rate. So if we know the space, the volume of the space, the area of the concrete, the radon level from that we've measured from measured outdoor levels, we can determine the ventilation rate, the emanation rate, and how much radon, how much additional air we need to get this building back to where it should be. So this is a little drawing showing our fan. At one point we were sucking air out of a dryer vent, and then we were blowing it into a single location. Now, a lot of times these systems, when they're fixed, are set into an air handler closet, which then mixes the air. we were dumping into one location. And when we dumped into one location, which in this case was the kitchen, we're dumping air into the kitchen. We were wondering, and then we would turn the fan up top, we had the fan off, and we're getting 5 picocuries in one room, 3, and then another time. They should have been the same. I'm not sure why they were different. But here we're getting the same readings when the ventilation fan's off. Now we turn a ventilation fan on and the radon levels decrease depending on whether the bedroom door is open. If the bedroom door is closed, then the kitchen's getting a lot more ventilation. And if the bedroom door is open, then the bedrooms are getting a little bit more. So that drops the bedrooms, but then it raises the kitchen. So you can see the effect of a single drop on the ventilation system and how it might influence. In other words, if you have an air-to-air heat exchanger and you're putting air just into the kitchen, is that going to fix the bedroom if they close the door? Well, it may not if the air handler is not running and circulating the air and distributing this ventilation air to that room. Now, down in Miami, we able to do a little more accurate measurements. We got in higher levels. We had levels here in this one unit that was 18 picocuries. We added 43 CFM and got it down to 0.33 air changes, a very small unit, 840 square feet, and got it down to 1.4 picocuries. So we took it from what you normally would say, oh, you can't fix ventilation problems that are over 10 picocuries. Well, you can if the ventilation's low. And how low was it? Not 0.05, we're looking at 0.03 air changes per hour, 4 CFM of natural ventilation is coming in. Ridiculously. I mean, it's ridiculous. And why is that? Well, it's concrete floors, concrete ceilings, radon coming, in some cases, radon coming from the hallway would just be more ventilation, but the door's weather stripped. And then it's got a sliding door. Well, that's tightly weather stripped. And it's got windows that are hurricane proof. So these buildings are extremely tight. The only ventilation may be some backflow that's coming in through a dryer, through the, say the dryer dryer vent or some leakage around the doors. So here's another one where we're looking at the same thing and we varied the ventilation. We added 50 CFM, then we said, oh, let's just change it a little bit, change it to 43. And we saw radon levels go from 2 to 2.8. So once again, looking at that 0.35 air changes per hour would be the required amount. And this unit had, it was a larger unit, and it had 5 CFM natural ventilation. I mean, ridiculously low. When the minimum, according to ASHRAE, is 56 CFM, so not even close. So the old ASHRAE standard was 0.35 air changes. And it's based on the total ventilation. Now we're talking about adding mechanical ventilation, which you have mechanical and natural. And then the new formula is pretty similar. It's 0.03 air changes per square foot, but then you add for bedrooms and you add 7.5 CFM for each bedroom and you throw in two times one bedroom, thinking that there'll be two people, there'll be higher ventilation requirement because there's two people in the master bedroom and one in the other bedrooms. So it's a new calculation, but it still comes out to that pretty close to 0.35 air changes per hour. So how do we fix it? Well, the best thing is to bring in centrally supplied conditioned air, because what's that doing? That's having an air handler on the rooftop of the unit that's 100% outdoor air, no return, it's all conditioned air. It's dehumidifying, it's heating it, there's no humidity issues. It's expensive. We're talking about major $100,000 plus costs to install these, and of course the ductwork coming down, and so now we're into multiple hundred thousand expenses split over all the buildings. But the maintenance department maintains it, it's always consistent, someone's always taking care of maintaining filters. It's the gold standard to how to fix these buildings, get the ventilation. The next way is energy recovery ventilators, bringing those in, and they do make an ERV and an HRV, and the ERV is what recovers some of the humidity, so the latent energy, and so you get some of that. Now you're gonna have to mount this unit find a place. It can't just be exposed in the unit. It's got to be put in a closet or drywalled in, but you've got to have access to there. Then you have to run two ducts to the outside and one duct over, typically to the return duct. Most of these buildings are air conditioned. And so you've got duct work, you've got drywall, you've got a lot of costs. A least expensive is a passive vent into the return air plenum. It turns out that a lot of condos have return plenums that have units in the closet that have no return ductwork. And that creates a very strong negative pressure. They have a louver door in there, but there's still a lot of negative pressure, and you can run a passive vent. Or what's often done now is what's called powered outdoor air vents, where they literally mount a small radon fan, a little 20-watt RP140 RN1 fans in the closet where the air handler is, run a single duct to the outside, and you need a vent, you need a grill, or you need a filter on that because you don't want to be sucking up bees and dirts, and that filter's got to be changed. And then either putting it on a speed control, but now they're preferring just to put on a timer because the timers are cheap and they're easy to use and it's easy to adjust and they're more stable. And the timer runs typically 25% of the time. So the fan's on, off, on, off. The issue with both the passive, but more so with the powered, is are we going to bring in more humidity than the building can handle? And that is an issue. Now, if the runtime is long and extensive for the air handler, air conditioning a building, and in the wintertime, there's less humidity issues. So we're talking about summer is the prime humidity. Of course, in Florida, it could be all year round. But the humidity coming in, if the air handlers are sized properly, then they run a lot. If an air handler for a condo is oversized, it cools too quickly and therefore does not suck the moisture out of the air because it's running for too short of a time. And then the radon bringing the fan in would induce higher amounts of moisture. So we're concerned about that. So here's our big rooftop units, tons of humidity coming out of that unit, half a gallon a minute out of this compressor. Here's our unit in Miami, and we tried a system in Miami of changing the hallway ventilation to 100% outdoor air rather than 25-30% outdoor air, and doing it 100% supplied, no return. So that was done as a test in there. ERVs, turns out you don't need a big ERV. The smallest one, Fantech makes one that's 67 CFM, it's a $500 unit. Of course, you've got all the costs with drywalling, as I mentioned before, and painting and doing the electric on those. So our powered unit it's going to try and fit in a closet. Here's a common thing. Look, you can see the grill right here for the return. It's just an open filter. Can we put a little radon fan in here? The homeowner's going to hear it. Okay, so there's some noise issue. Then they run flex duct typically outside and then drywall and box around the drywall it. And then there's a vent that's put on the outside with some kind of removable filter. They have a timer in here. They may have electric already in here, although it might be 220. You might have to run some electric. Keep in mind that fan, that'll move more air. We're talking about 50 CFM, 60 CFM. These things will move 140 CFM. But then having it on a timer, you can change the runtime on it to work it so it gives you the radon reduction and minimize the impact of humidity that would be on the space. So we did find that in North Carolina, it was a very cold time when we did it, and we ran the air handler. We didn't run the air handler. Excuse me, the air handler was turned off. There was no one in the building. It was a vacant unit, and we were bringing in 40 CFM. And when we brought 40 CFM in the wintertime, we saw no change in the temperature in the unit, even though we were bringing in 40 CFM. So a lot of thermal mass there seemed to handle that amount of air coming in when the weather outside was quite cold. The humidity did start to decrease. It's drier air coming in. And so you're going to have this humidity change. So that's pretty much the end of my talk. If there's questions, and Sarah or Phil wants to bring those over to me, and also I want to point out that my website has the papers that I talked about, and a lot of other information, and I'll probably be posting this this webinar up there too, or link to it in the future. So a lot of people like to visit the website and pick up information, a lot of fan information, such not there available for everyone.
Sure.
Okay.
Hey, so Bill, we have one question so far. Well, actually, it's a two-parter. Was there any concern about the interference between the radon eye detector and the proximity to the metal bowl? And was there any indication that this impacted or skewed measurements?
Okay, so as far as the radon eye, it's not sensitive. As far as I know, well, it wouldn't be sensitive to the bowl because the bowl is just an inert piece of metal and it's not picking up some magnetic field that would affect it. I've used those units all over the place and never had them give spurious readings. They are, as I would highly recommend them to be used as diagnostic instruments because they respond in 13 minutes. They give a very quick response time. And so we've used them in houses where we go and we have a problem house. We're not sure where the radon's coming from, or we want to check the garage and this and that. We'll go out with six of these units, pop them around with their little batteries or plug them in. And I've never had an interference off of them, but what's great about them is 13 minutes, I have the first reading, and every 10 minutes after that. And the first reading is about 80% of the actual. So it's a great little tool to use. And so for flux measurements, diagnostic stuff, they're pretty handy and low cost.
Why does it have to be a metal bowl? Couldn't it be a plastic one as well?
That's a good question. It's amazing how radon will diffuse right through plastic. And so now you've got the diffusion. In other words, you're doing it over a day, but if you build up to a certain amount of radon within that chamber, it's going to start diffusing through and losing its radon concentration there. So glass, you can use a glass bowl, a metal bowl. You could use plastic if you lined it with aluminum foil tape. Literally, radon goes right through plastic.
Okay.
So that's why you can't use plastic. And the problem is the bigger the bowl, the less the response because it's going into a bigger thing. So you kind of want a small bowl. You want as tight a volume, but a nice area that it's encapsulating the concrete.
Okay, another question, which I just lost, but I believe it was, was there a battery pack next to the radon eye?
Yeah, and the issue with radon eye is they run at 12 volts, and all the little battery packs that we get for our cell phones are all 5 volts. So they're pretty inexpensive. I just bought one I'm going on a trip and I just got one for $10. You know, it's 10,000 milliamp hours. I usually try and get a 20,000 milliamp one. But they do make a converter, a little plug converter that will convert 5 volts to 12 volts. And if you hunt around, you can find a 12 volt portable battery too that would plug in, but then you need the cable to make the connection. On my website, under the diagnostic section, there's a little talk about how you could, the batteries and making connections for that unit. I mean, you could run it, you could plug it in and have the cord go underneath the caulking and just seal around that too. As long as you've got a good air seal, that would be another option.
Okay. Let's see, were there any other questions? Let's see, what were the age of the buildings?
Oh, the Miami building was 3 years old. And when I went down to the Charlotte building, that was about 3 years old. They were very new. And there is some variation in the emanation of radon coming out of concrete over time. And it actually increases a bit as time goes on. And there's factors with water migration, the amount of water that's in the concrete that would reduce the emanation. And then the question is, in a 10-inch wall, does radon make it out from the center of the concrete? There's a lot of different issues, but the predominant thing is, it will continue to emanate for it forever because it's based on radium, not forever, but 18 years. The half-life of radium is 1,500 years, so long time.
So one of our listeners or our attendees says that they have been seeing similar situations in Fort Myers, Florida. It hasn't been that uncommon. Philip asks if you'll quickly speak to the crushed rock granite versus slabs situation.
Are you referring to granite countertops, or are you talking about what's underneath or what's in there?
So Bill, you have spoken before where I've heard you speak about the potential for a greater emanation from crushed rock versus a slab, increasing the surface area in which emanation's from.
Yeah, well, if you think in terms of a stone foundation and you've got these big rocks, you know, in that stone foundation, how much radon are we getting out of those rocks? And that kind of like what I alluded to in the concrete, can radon come from the center of the concrete out? Can radon make it from the interior of a rock to the exterior, or is it only what's emanating off the surface? And truthfully, I can't give you any answers to that at all. However, if you, I know if you took a rock and crushed it, you would have a higher potential for release of radon because it doesn't have to diffuse through the rock itself.
If you wouldn't mind going ahead and giving your perspective on granite countertops, that is a topic that I know that I get a lot of questions about. So if you'd share your thoughts on that or any research.
Yeah, the granite countertop thing took off, and Mike Keto was doing some measurements out of New York, and Mike sent me the hottest granite he could find. He sent me pieces and said, hey, test this. I'm like, okay, that'll be fun. So we tested these granite, and we found pieces, sections of the granite that was putting out 500, not 50 picocuries per square foot per hour, but 500. Picocuries per square foot per hour. But it was not like a uniform, like over the entire thing. It would be these little streaks that went through it or whatever. Okay. Then we take the 500 picocuries per hour and we go, okay, how much surface air? Okay. We got a countertop. It's 2 feet wide. It's 10 feet by 20 feet, whatever. And we calculate and we go, wow, that's like a tenth of a picocurie. Well, what, maybe the kitchen's really tight. Oh, maybe we get it really tighter. And as much as we would try and get the ventilation low and the amount of granite countertops high, we couldn't get it to contribute much mathematically and looking at what we were measuring. So we're like, I don't think it was possible. And the interesting thing is no one's replicated a house with elevated radon from granite. In other words, one guy went in and claimed it was an issue. And when B.B. Alvarez and I went into New York, or he went into New York and he did some measurements on a very small apartment that had granite, very hot granite, and we couldn't see any elevation in that unit either. I mean, it's, once again, it's a combination of this issue with condos is a combination of so much concrete everywhere and uniform. And you know, the floor and the ceiling in combination with extremely airtight ventilation is what the issue is. So that's the long answer. The short answer is it's almost impossible for granite countertops to contribute any measurable amount of radon to the building. Okay. So it was a completely overblown scare. Yeah.
We have another question. Just to be clear, we were told that a Lexan bucket typically used by restaurant supply businesses could indeed be used if taped to the concrete floor. So are you saying that radon would diffuse through that?
What kind of bucket again, Sarah?
It says a Lexan, L-E-X-A-N.
Oh, like a Lexan or something. Okay. You're getting into something I don't know, and that would be the density of plastic and whether certain plastics would exclude radon. So yes, there may be some plastic materials that really reduce emanation, that radon really has a hard time emanating through. I mean, it's like, does duct tape work? I mean, what stops radon? We know metal does, and I know glass does. And I've been wanting to do a research project on radon seal, the paint that's, if you click on radon seal, you'll get this company on the internet that sells a paint that excludes radon. And I actually made some measurements and it actually worked pretty well. I was surprised painting that on the concrete made a difference. So it's possible to find a bucket and then coat it or tape it or something. But generally the best thing is a metal bucket. I mean, you can also go to the hardware store and get an old metal, the metal pans they use, the milk pans, you know, those kind of things. And I would still caulk the joints in them just to make it totally airtight, but you could use that. So you have an old Sun nuclear device or something that's kind of large, you want to try it out, and that's what you have. Okay, well, get a bucket that'll fit over the Sun nuclear monitor, but just find a little metal bucket. And then it's a formula, and you need to go back to my papers to look at the formulas, but it's pretty straightforward. It's just the volume. It's the radon emanation into that volume. So you're dividing by the volume in liters, and then you're multiplying it times the square foot area that it's covering. So if it's 2 square feet, you multiply by 2. If it's half a square foot, you multiply by 0.5. And then that gives you the picocuries per square foot per hour when you look at the ingrowth after you let the radon monitor goes and it's the radon levels creeping up, and then you're looking at that ingrowth over what period of time. So, I mean, someone in Charlotte took a charcoal canister and put it underneath a piece of poly, taped the poly to the wall and put the charcoal canister, and they got a very high reading. And it was like, well, you know, that tells you there's some radon coming out of that concrete. But we don't know how much, you know, or what rate it's coming out.
Okay.
So, you know, someone might want to do that if they have a monitor and they're reading 10 picocuries. Gee, is the floor contributing? And they could put their monitor and then put a piece of plastic over it and find out that, wow, it's reading twice as high as the one in the room. And it'd be like, okay, well, that's suspicious. Therefore, maybe we should do some more measurements. But it's always in combination with airtight homes. And as we make our houses more airtight, we're running into more indoor air quality problems, and radon in particular. So of levels, you tighten up a building, you make a building twice as tight, and a building with 3 will picocuries will suddenly be 6 picocuries.
Yep. Have you tested glazed ceramic tile over concrete slab floor?
Well, I can tell you with some granite, radon went right through the granite, and some granite, very little came through. Like if you, on some of the granite we get have coatings on it, and it would have a coating on one side, and sometimes the radon would go right through that coating, and sometimes the coating, like some kind of epoxy thing or whatever, it wouldn't go through it at all. So absolutely, you start putting some material down on the floor, and if I was trying to stop emanation, I would probably look at like a concrete floor, look at vinyl, like a sheet stock vinyl, I think would probably be a pretty good reducer of radon. But I'm hoping at some point to do some talking to Mike Keto and doing some testing on some different materials as this issue of emanation comes up and as we try and get radon levels lower. But ventilation's also a key component of this whole factor. So, you know, do we or do we not need to do that? And we certainly have mitigated buildings and they come back at 2.5 picocuries and like, why is it 2.5 when I have vacuum under the entire floor? Well, it could be that it's, even though you have vacuum under the entire floor, you're getting emanation through or out of the concrete that's giving you that 2.5. And if somebody wants it at 1.5, they may have to stop the emanation or increase the ventilation.
Okay. That's the end of our questions. So thank you.
Okay. All right. It was a great session.
Bill, okay. Thank you so much. Sarah, thank you so much for everyone. This is not the end. We have 2 more webinars happening this month. Next week will be Jay Hyland, who will be giving a presentation, which is a Maine perspective, the state of Maine, that is, considerations and radon mitigation standards. But Bill will be back on February the 27th, and I'm excited that he's going to be presenting on school mitigation design considerations, which is again, another topic that is somewhat related to this one, but nonetheless, it'll be handled differently and subject matter will certainly be, I think, helpful for a lot of, I know people in North Carolina, but also outside of North Carolina. So Bill, thank you again so much for presenting to me. This has been really insightful for me. I've learned a lot, and I'm hoping that the participants also find this of help. So thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're very welcome. Everyone, yeah, thanks for doing a great job.